Hey, I'm Pastor Shane. Welcome to another episode of Family Foundations. You know, I've never really been a guy that's made a lot of New Year's resolutions, but I did this year. And this year, my resolution is to fight on behalf of my family against any power that would seek to harm or suppress my family's ability to live as Christ has commanded us. You know, if you haven't made a New Year's resolution yet, it should be also to fight for your family. You know, I'm fired up about this one, so let's get into it. In John chapter 12, verse 31, John describes Satan as the ruler of this world. He is then the major influence on the ideals, opinions, goals, hopes, and views of the majority of the world. His influence also encompasses the world's philosophies, education systems, and commerce. The thoughts, ideas, speculations, and false religions of the world are all under his control and have sprung from his lies and deception. He works in the shadows as not to be detected, and many believers are being led astray because of his deception. In Ephesians chapter 5, Paul, he urges us to be mindful of how we walk in these evil times. For if our minds are not set on things of God, we will align with the things of the world. Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 3, he tells us that when we suffer as Christians, and we will suffer as Christians, it's better to suffer for doing what is good. What Peter means when he says good, it is not the same as what the world today would say good is. To be good is to align your life with Christ and his teachings. That is what we are to pursue and emulate and bear witness to. And that is actually what Satan is trying to stop. What I am saying is that Satan is fighting against you and your family, and we need to fight back. You know, I was reading through the book of Nehemiah over the Christmas break, and the book of Nehemiah, it's viewed as a leadership book, and it's true, it is a leadership book. We need leaders, especially in our families. We need leaders in our churches, in our communities. And Nehemiah, he was a Jew who was in exile, and he heard of this fellow countrymen back in Jerusalem, and they were being attacked and badly influenced because they didn't have any defenses. You know, it was placed upon his heart to then return to Jerusalem and rebuild the walls. Nehemiah then faced some opposition. And then I was struck by an address that Nehemiah gave to his fellow workers when they were experiencing this opposition. In chapter 4, verse 14 of the book of Nehemiah, this is what it says. It says, "When I saw their fear, I rose and spoke to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. Do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses." Fight for your family. That really is what Nehemiah is saying. He is urging his fellow Jews to stand up against whatever powers are coming against them and fight for their families. So what is actually coming against Nehemiah, and what is he then fighting for? You know, there are a couple reasons why Nehemiah sets out to rebuild the walls around Jerusalem. You know, firstly, simply, is the walls provide safety. You know, without proper defenses, the city is completely open to attacks from other nations. This not only threatens the physical safety of people, but when other nations come in and take over a city, with them then comes their customs, their rituals, their idol worship. And for a Jew who was given the law from Moses, and the law was the means in which they actually fellowshiped with God, these attacks could then also prevent or persuade them from even worshiping God. Now, I don't want to advocate for you to join a gated community or hide your family away from the world. We need to be in the world, but not of the world. What I'm saying is that we need to be aware of what is at our city gates. We actually even need to be aware of what has maybe even entered into our cities. So think as a parent, envision your family being its own little city. You have this wall that surrounds your family. And what the wall does is that it not only keeps your family together, but when you go up on top of the wall, it lets you look out to see if there are any potential threats that are coming against your family. You can even look in and see if there are any threats against your family. You know, and the gates, they allow you to control what comes in and out. So think about it. What then are the threats that are seeking to penetrate past your family walls and enter into your city? Remember, Satan is the major influencer of the day. So then how is the rise of secularism, which is a societal movement where God is basically absent, how is that, you know, affecting your wall? What about the COVID pandemic, mandatory vaccine mandates? What about critical race theory, socialism? What about wokeness, feminism, conversion therapy and the ban, gender, sexual perversion, materialism, entertainment culture? You can just keep on listing things. The threats will just keep going on, and they're seeking to come against the Christian family. And without strong walls, without being aware, your family might be susceptible to a worldly influence. So this is the first reason why Nehemiah wanted to rebuild the city walls, simply to safeguard from foreign influence. But there's a second reason, because Nehemiah knew that God's people need to really be where God is. You know, Nehemiah, he recalls a promise that God gave them through Moses. In chapter 1 of Nehemiah, verses 8 and 9, Nehemiah says this. He says, "Remember the word which you commanded your servant Moses, saying, 'If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though those of you who have been scattered were in the most remote part of the heavens, I will gather them from there and will bring them to the place,'" check this out, "'where I have chosen to cause my name to dwell.'" The whole nation of Israel, they were scattered, they were in disarray. Being scattered and exiled, they had adopted foreign gods and customs, and they were not able to live as the people that God had called them to be. But a rebuilt city would offer them the needed protection to again be able to come together and be God's people. And the rebuilt city would allow the rest of the world then the opportunity to actually see God's people for who they were supposed to be. And not only that, as they lived obediently as God's people, God would be with them. He would be in their midst. You know, a life that is dedicated to striving towards obedience to Christ is also a life that is filled with the presence of Christ. And the presence of Christ is enough for us, at least it should be. And our eternity is all about being in the presence of Christ. Our temporary time here on earth needs to be as well. And if our walls are not strong, other things could then invade and convince us ultimately that Christ is not enough. And that's what Satan wants to do. So ultimately, what we are trying to do as parents who are then discipling our kids is we want to teach them to love God. We want to teach them to love others. We want them to know God, to model his character, and then build into others. We want them to be able to understand the differences between the ways of God and the ways of the world. We want them to discern right from wrong and to make a life of obedience to Christ a priority. But this does not happen if God is not in our midst. And if God is on the outside of our city walls, chances are we're going to view him as a threat instead of a friend. Remember, we're all being influenced by something. So what are you being influenced by? What are your kids being influenced by? And are we really, to the best of our abilities, living as God's people? And this is what Nehemiah is encouraging his fellow Jews to fight for. They need to fight like their lives depended on it, because being the people of God and having God dwell in their midst is all that they needed. And this is all we need. But the world wants to destroy our ability to do this. You know, I know the prospect of fighting back, it can cause fear. I get it. You know, and I have my own fears about fighting back against the evil in this world. But Nehemiah and the Jews, they fought through their fear And they built the wall in 52 days. Now, check this out, okay? This is what happened after they built the wall. Chapter 6, verses 15 to 16 of Nehemiah says, "So the wall was completed, and when all our enemies heard of it, and all the nations surrounding us saw it, they lost their confidence, for they recognized that this work had been accomplished with the help of our God." When we build up the walls around our family, when we fight to live as God's people, and then welcome God into our midst, the enemy will be the one who distances himself from your city walls. Did you catch that? If you want to make a difference in this world, in your work, in your family, it comes through the building of your walls. It comes through fighting for your family and seeking with your whole being to build a city, so to speak, with God in your midst, that keeps the ways of the world out and the ways of God in. So if you feel like materialism is a threat to your family, maybe how you manage your time, maybe it's socialism, maybe it's wokeness, maybe it's being distracted in some different way by the phone or by the world or by video games, maybe we're living in fear, maybe it's the COVID lockdowns, whatever you believe is a threat to our ability to lead our family, to love God and to love others, then fight back against it. You know, Paul urged Timothy in 1 Timothy to do this very thing. Recognize the ways in which the world is going to seek to lead you astray and run away from those things and fight for what God has called you to do. And this is what he says in 1 Timothy 6, verse 12. He says, "Fight the good fight of faith." I love what my study Bible says about this verse. And this is what it says. It says, Paul uses active and forceful verses to describe the Christian life. Some think Christianity is a passive religion that advocates waiting for God to act. But we must have an active faith, obeying God with courage and doing what we know is right. Man, the time to act is now. The time is now for us to fight for our families. As usual, if you have any thoughts, questions, or comments, feel free to send me an email. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.